Welcome. And many of them. Susio Talk. Ah. Episode 21. 21 savage episodes of Susio Talk. Not stopping. All right? So hopefully all of you are doing well this week. It's been a long 7 days, a lot of hard work. My afro is coming in exquisitely, for those of you who want to know. So, the DMX funeral was this past... Before I talk about that, I'm getting into the intro without even letting you guys know what the hell you're getting in for. What the hell you're here for. Joe Sasto. Chef Joe Sasto was a competitor on Top Chef, worked under Chef Michael Tusk for many years. He's in love with pasta. You can see him doing pasta cooking videos nowadays on his own website, everything like that, just sort of, you know, self-sustained chef, teaching people the wonderful techniques behind pasta making. So we've been trying to get the podcast up and running for a while. And finally, you know, after pandemics and vaccinations and all that, we were able to make it happen. So he invited me into his place, and we had a great time working on talking about his career and sort of what he's into now, and it's kind of an amazing time in being a chef, because you can, you know, broadcast from your own home and it's not looked down upon, you know. Kudos and shout out to those chefs who were doing this before it was popular and dealt with the negativity of the haters, including myself, you know. I was thinking the other day about this cryptocurrency business, and, you know, a lot of people are on the fence about it. They're like, I don't know, I don't know. And at the end of the day, I think it's the way of the future. I think if you try to deny these things, which are inevitably going to change, you're not going to benefit fully from them. For example, when YouTube came out, right? I was like, I don't want to be a fucking idiot making videos of myself and putting them on YouTube. I wish I had. You know what I'm saying? These fools out here making multi-million dollars making funny videos? Like, come on, you know? But as I said before, everything in your own time, right? So I'm not beating myself up like, oh, I can't believe it. I missed that wave. Also, when podcasts came out, I was like, what the fuck is a podcast? You know, I don't want to listen to that. And here I am, 14 years after I said that, wishing I'd have started a podcast sooner. But it's okay, because the experiences in your life shape you and make you do certain things. And, you know, I think I'm happy about where I'm at in my life and what it's taken me to get here. No way, shape, or form am I regretful. But there is definitely something to be said about shutting new things out because you don't believe in them or you're scared of them. To be honest, I think that's what the, you know, people don't want to lose money on this cryptocurrency business. And as we saw with the GameStop stocks and all that, financial, you know, moves are changing, and you can make a living these days without needing the things that you needed, you know, 20 years ago, master's degree and all that. There's more avenues to make money and more avenues for people to do what they truly love, you know, and if you love it and it helps others, then why not do it, you know? So back to the DMX funeral. They had him in a red casket on a monster truck that they were driving through New York, visiting all his old hoods and his other rappers' hoods, and just like all the rappers were there. As Swizz Beatz made beautiful comments. I didn't get to watch it all, but I saw, you know, some highlights of it. So say what you say about that man, but at the end of the day, the respect is there, and you can tell by the funeral that his friends and family put together and how many people attended that were fans, not just family. So something to be said there. The new Mortal Kombat movie came out, and I think people are holding it to too high a standard. Like, it's not going to be an amazing movie, guys, right? It's an action movie based on a video game, okay? So I thought they did a great job, but I've been seeing a lot of hate on the internet. Not like, you know, crazy negative hate, but just people saying like, oh, I didn't like the movie. But at the end of the day, it had action. It was funny. There was bad acting in it, which is everything you need for a great martial arts movie. Like, let's be honest, right? And at the end of the day, the movie's for kids. Like, it's, I guess not. There was people, like, getting cut up with chainsaws. I take that back. Mortal Kombat, not for kids. Wu-Tang, always for the children, all right? Joe Rogan had a, if you guys don't know this, Joe Rogan has the best podcast. I'm sure you probably know this, because there's no way you're listening to my podcast if you haven't listened to Joe Rogan's podcast, you know? So he had a podcast on, and he had this guest, was this doctor. Her name was Dr. Shauna Swan. She's an environmental epidemiologist whose work examines the impact of chemical exposure on reproductive health and child development. And she has a book called Countdown. It's available now. Dr. Shauna Swan, S-H-A-N-N-A-S-W-A-N, Dr. D-R, period. So Dr. Shauna, she was talking about the fact that any food that has been in contact with certain plastics will leach out into those foods and eventually end up in our bodies, and it's lowering male sperm counts. It's making our taints smaller. I know that you guys are going to think, why is he talking about small taints? Well, apparently it's a problem. All right, guys, I'm not a doctor, but there's a doctor out here explaining these things. So listen to the podcast. It's one of his shorter ones. It's only an hour and a half. Usually they're like 3 hours long, but she gets right down to the point, explains all the issues that are going on with all the plastic and how we can get rid of this. And then I was listening to the Bill Burr podcast, those are my two main podcasts. And he was talking about this water called Liquid Death. Right? And I've been looking at this water at the store, like, why would I buy canned water? Right? But at the end of the day, I think it's going to, you know, take away all the usage of plastic, and the entire can is 100% reusable. So I think Liquid Death, I think I'm going to get into buying that water, you know, and you feel good, you know, and it empowers the water. It's in a can. It's in a tall boy pounder. You know what I'm saying? You feel badass drinking it, you know, instead of these little flimsy plastic bottles that are all over the place. And, you know, you see them on the beach, you see them on the street. It's time to get away from that. Like, we are fucking this place up, you know. And anyway, let me not go too far down that rabbit hole. But check out Dr. Shauna Swan podcast. It was a really good one, and I really enjoyed it. So Joe Sasto invited me, and I want to also thank his girlfriend, Bella Bennett. She is the creative director almost, she is the writer and creative director for Joe Sasto. All right. Basically, she's behind the camera. She's, you know, helping him out, as they go out to eat, they film, you know, while they eat, which is something that's kind of new for me because, you know, most times it's a picture of the place, either a picture of the plate, a picture of a half-eaten plate, a picture of someone sitting down. But to take a video while you're at a restaurant, and review it sort of as you're eating it, you know, I'd never seen that before. So hopefully that takes off because that's pretty interesting. So Bella Bennett, thank you for letting me into your home and to interview your man, Chef Joe Sasto. I can't stop saying that last name. I love the last name. Oh, while I'm doing this, I'm getting somebody's tweeting out, not tweeting out, mentioning me in the story. Here we go. We got Jacob Aaron Wilson. That's on Instagram. Jacob Aaron Wilson. Talking about that Nick Tamburo episode 20, A New York Chef in Wine Country, just came out last week on the Sucio Talk podcast. He said that feeling in your stomach never goes away. And he's talking about the butterflies there. That important feeling of that a human should have when they're you know, doing something challenging, and it's like, am I going to fail this? Am I going to fall on my face? What would I do if I fell on my face? The answer is always get up. All right? And actually, let me tell you a story about canned water. We're gonna go back to canned water for a second here. I'm taking a flight from Puerto Rico to Texas. Right at the time, I had a girlfriend that lived there, so I took a plane from Puerto Rico to Texas. I never gotten drunk at the airport before, so I figured this is the perfect time to do that because I'm here like 4 hours early. My dad could always drop me off or whatever. So I was in layover somewhere, I think in New York. Yeah, because you got to fly from, it's weird. You have to fly from Puerto Rico to New York. This was JetBlue, then New York to, I believe, Austin Airport. So I get in there and I get to the bar. I'm like, oh, maybe I should order some food. And I'm like, ah, it's a little bit too pricey. So I end up having four margaritas, okay, which is, I probably could have had two margaritas and a meal and been good, but I didn't do that, right? So I get hammered. Not only that, I'm walking, I'm feeling good. I'm like that confident hammered, right? I'm walking to the gate. I'm like, whoa, I'm on time. I'm actually a little bit early. So I sit down at the bar right next to the gate and have a Coors Light. So at this point, I'm four margaritas and a Coors Light. I get in the plane, I sit down, immediately pass out. This is like a 7 hour or 6 hour flight, right? So we're flying into Austin. As the plane starts to descend, I snap out of it, wake up, and I'm so nauseous, right? I have to puke immediately, okay? And I'm sorry if you're eating your breakfast while you listen to this. So I'm sitting there and I grab that little bag. It's the first time in my life that I'm grabbing this little the little paper bag that you have there. It's plastic lined in case you're gonna throw up. And I go at it, right? And I fill the entire bag up. So I'm holding it onto it, right? And then the seat in next to me is empty. I'm in the window. And the seat in the aisle has there's a man there, and I can't even talk. I'm like, your bag. He's like, what? I'm like, I need your bag. Then he looks over and he sees that I have this full plastic bag, and he's like, or you know, paper bag, and he's like, here you go. So he gives me his paper bag, and I also fill that one up, right? So we land in Austin, and I have two of these bags full of my body juice, and I land with these things kind of like holding them up so they don't spill, like, you know, trying to go with the plane so nothing seeps out of the bag and like explodes all over the plane, you know? So we finally land and you know, everybody starts getting up, and before everybody starts getting up, the stewardess or the flight attendant, I'm sorry, walks down the aisle and she goes, "Oh, those are you know," she has a trash bag with her. And she's like, that's actually a chemical, so we need a special bag for that. So I had to wait till everyone got off the plane, and I'm sitting like maybe on row 10. So everyone from row 11 to 30 is just walking by, watching me hold these two bags of puke up. And finally, they give me the trash bag. I throw out the two bags of puke, and I am in rough shape. I need some water bad. Like, I don't even know what to do with myself. I'm still drunk, and I'm sick, and I'm like, this was the worst idea ever. Never got drunk in the airport ever again. But I get to Austin, and I go get water from this machine, and the water that comes out is canned water. And I'm like, the first time I've ever seen canned water. And I'm like, this is fucking ridiculous. I don't, like, whatever. I start drinking it. I crack it open, right? I start drinking it. And the taste of the aluminum was so strong that I just puked again right then and there in front of the vending machine. And, yeah, so three times into the can of water. So at this point I can't get water, right? Then I walk out, my girlfriend at the time is picking me up from the airport. And, you know, I hadn't seen her in a month. I had been in Puerto Rico eating peanut butter and jelly sandwiches every single day, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And I gained like 40 pounds. It was the heaviest I've ever been. I had gotten these huge Let's just call them rapist style glasses, right? The Jeffrey Dahmer's huge, right? So they were, I wasn't looking so appealing, right? I came around with a beer belly and like just, right, skinny fat, just completely out of shape and disgusting. Plus I'm hammered, I stink like alcohol, and the first thing I say to her is, take me to a Denny's. And that is my story about getting hammered on the plane. All right? So episode 21, Joe Sasto. Please enjoy. Next week, I got Chef Nico Pena of Octavia Restaurant in SF. I actually did these two interviews the same day. So next week, you'll get to hear Nico talk about his trajectory through San Francisco kitchens. So everyone enjoy the week. Remember, when you're listening to Susio talk, put that on your social media. Let everybody know what's up. All right? Peace. All right.
All right. Welcome, everybody. Susio talk, episode 21, Savage. We got my man, Chef Joe Sasto in the house. Chef, what's up?
What's going on? How are you?
I'm well. Thanks for having me. Nice to finally get to talk to you a little bit, because last time I saw you, you were at the Charter Oak.
That was a long time ago.
I know, right?
We have been talking about doing this podcast for a very long time.
For a very long time. Very long time.
I'm glad we didn't do it virtually.
Yeah, like, for sure. Right, we almost did, and then we were like, you know what? Let's wait. Let's talk face to face.
We're masked up right now the sake of placing a sense of time and place.
Hell yeah.
Because I don't know when you're going to listen to this, but we're sitting here 6 feet apart wearing masks. So definitely a unique time, I guess.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. So, Chef, you know, here at Susio Talk, we're going to take it all the way back to when you were a little niño. All right. So where'd you grow up?
Starting way back. So I was born in New York City.
Okay.
I feel like I was only there for a couple of years, because that's all I remember. I was there till I was six.
Okay.
So it feels like when I think about it, I was like, 3 years. But I guess 3 years is what I really remember.
Yeah.
And the rest is kind of like photographs and things. But my family, after my dad retired, moved to Vegas.
Okay.
If you're not familiar, Nevada has no state income tax.
Uh-huh.
So that was a great place to retire. At the time, it was up and coming.
Uh-huh.
It was like a family-oriented town. Obviously, Las Vegas has gone through many different iterations. Yeah. At one point, it was like family-focused. Then it like kind of went to like the poker, World Series of Poker age.
Very true.
I think now they're in kind of like the DJ, nightclub, day club,
EDM,
party,
electric
EDM
music
scene.
Yeah, like,
I don't know what it'll be, you know, by the time life moves on, but, at the time it was a unique place to grow up, no doubt.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's where I spent elementary, middle, high school.
Okay.
I guess a lot of my formative years.
All right. Going back to New York, were you what borough?
I was born in Flushing. We had a house in Queens.
Okay. Okay. Did you, do you have any memories from when
Very little. Like, I knew we were near the airport because I remember planes flying over. I remember Concords. Remember those things?
Yeah.
Like, super loud across the country in, like, what, 2 hours or something wild?
Wow.
But those obviously don't exist anymore.
Jesus.
But I remember that. I remember, like, some, like, snow.
Yeah.
That was my only experience of ever living somewhere where it snowed.
Okay, so you never lived anywhere cold after that?
Never.
Whoa, okay. All right.
Yeah.
There you go. So when you moved to Vegas, you said your dad retired. What did he retire from?
My dad retired. He had worked in the Long Island Correctional Department.
Yeah. I mean, there's a big culture of that in the Northeast.
Yes.
My mother's correctional officer in Connecticut, so. Respect.
Yep. So he did that and then retired and took the family out west.
Got you. Was he planning on opening any other businesses?
He stayed kind of in the public service sector. He was a bailiff for a while we grew up.
Heard that.
He did private security for hotels and casinos, things like that.
Got you.
And so he was always kind of in that, you know, protect.
And then, was it hard growing up under that?
protective? I didn't realize necessarily till maybe I got older.
Okay.
And then was more exposed to other people, other things. Like, you don't realize, or at least I didn't realize, like, growing up in Vegas, how different Las Vegas was than a lot of other people. And then when I moved to Northern California for college, I was, like, kind of introduced into a whole different group of people, world of people. And it was very, like, mind-opening in that sense. And I had no idea how maybe closed off I was living in a city like that, even though it's a huge city.
Yeah.
And then I moved to this small little city. I went to UC Davis, so it was like a tiny little college town. But it seemed so much more open and different than anything I had seen before.
Gotcha. And then you said your dad retired. Was your mom still working?
My mom didn't work the whole time we were growing up until maybe, I don't know, high school. She kind of, she loved teaching.
Okay.
And so she went back to teaching and was a teacher. And so started as a substitute teacher, but then, like, loved it so much.
Yeah.
Went into teaching full time. And so, she schooled my brothers and I in addition to public school.
All right.
So,
like,
she was very hands-on.
Yeah.
With learning, with projects, with writing,
reading,
and kind of, like, very much nurturing in that sense.
And, you know, you're living in Las Vegas. Were you guys, like, hanging out at the Strip? Or, I mean, what is that? I don't know.
That is the most common question. When you tell us about, like, I haven't heard that question in so long because I rarely talk about Vegas.
Yeah.
But literally, like, when I was meeting people for the first time, they're like, oh, you're from Vegas? Like, your parents must work in a hotel. Like, do you live on the Strip? How often are you down there? No, I mean, Vegas is a huge city. I mean, think of it like L.A. or Chicago. Mm-hmm. It's, like, very spread out. You know, maybe the freeways then were very well connected and not congested at all. You could go from this small little suburb we lived in and get to the Strip in, like, 10 minutes.
Yeah.
But it didn't at all feel like you were part of the Strip or living on.
Or you had to go there.
No.
Okay. Got you.
No.
So what are some activities in Las Vegas as a child that, you know, don't have to do with that kind of thing?
A lot of what we did kind of still, the entertainment was in the casinos.
Okay. Okay.
So, like, I remember being young, places like the Excalibur, the Luxor, the MGM were all very family child focused. Excalibur had, like, free shows, like knights and dragons and fire breathing and jugglers and kind of, like, in that vein. MGM was Wizard of Oz focused at the time. So they had, like, a Yellow Brick Road and Dorothy and the Tin Man and the Lion. Luxor was, you know, the whole Egyptian vibe, kind of, like, so it was very entertaining and a lot of, like, free entertainment in that sense, or you could get, like, passed to the buffet, or, you know, food was a very big focus for us.
So yeah,
it was like,
for
we're going to the Strip, let's go to a buffet. That was, like, a big thing and a big deal. And, like, it would take our whole day, spend the whole day.
There's nothing better than a buffet in Las Vegas.
That, I mean, it is. I didn't realize how much of a Vegas iconic thing it was.
Oh, man.
But it's very much just Vegas. Yeah. Don't go to buffets in California.
Not really. I'm thinking, though, food industry, we need to bring the buffet back.
I think the buffet's gotten such a bad rap because it's hard to do well.
Yeah, for sure.
So it's like Vegas has the infrastructure to do that, and they have so many people eating, so food's constantly coming out.
Yeah, for sure.
Like, there's a lot of little gears and cogs that it takes to make a buffet worthwhile.
Yeah.
And so, like, I think the way Vegas comes together makes that happen.
For sure. So, you know, food was a big part of your life. You guys going out to eat. Are you guys eating at home? Are you guys cooking at home?
Oh, yeah. Like, okay. Food was everything. And yeah. That was all my mom.
Okay.
So, like, maybe growing up, we weren't, like, we were definitely by no means wealthy. So food became the thing my mom and my parents would use to kind of entertain my brothers and I.
Heard that.
And so, like, whether it be her cooking or just picking up, like, a rotisserie chicken from the grocery store, unpackaging it, plating it, making it all, like, food was the center of our family life.
Yeah.
And back then it wasn't like cell phones, but turn off the TV, everybody around the table, just about every night of the week. And even if it wasn't just the family, friends were over, our neighbors were over, and yeah. It was very much kind of this thing that brought us all together. So I learned very early on, the power of food, and
yeah.
How it can affect people, how it can touch people, how it can create memories, how it could evoke memories, and all of these things that I, unbeknownst, fell in love with
and
would shape and form my journey for the rest of my life.
Gotcha. Did you think you were ever going to do anything else before?
Like, at one point, I know I have always been in love with the idea of hospitality.
Okay.
Because prior to knowing I wanted to cook, I wanted to be, when I was a kid. I'm like, you know, oh, what do you want to be, a firefighter or an astronaut? I want to be a hotel owner.
Yeah.
I wanted to be able to welcome people into a place and take care of them and provide for them. And I loved the idea of hotels as a kid. And I was like, oh my God, it's special occasions, so great. And so that was something very, very early on when I was very young. I was like, oh yeah, what a great thing. I want to be a hotel owner. But now thinking back on it, that was just kind of like the early signs of how much I cared.
Yeah.
And was passionate about hospitality.
For
which,
sure.
Now being a chef, that is like the biggest thing that we do.
Yeah. Apart from the food. Hell yeah. That's something that matters. So when did you pursue this? When did you?
So I had always been cooking early on with my mom. She had me in the kitchen. There are photos of me cooking at her side at like one of those little Tykes tables, mixing together like flour and water.
Yeah, yeah.
Not making anything, just making a mess.
Got you.
And she would be preparing dinner. And then kind of as I got older, I would be cooking with her in the kitchen. I would help out. I'd always want to be around food, whether it's the holiday, Sunday, any night of the week. I was just kind of attracted to it. Where other kids were maybe outside playing sports,
yeah.
Watching cartoons. Mm-hmm. I was like watching the early days of Food Network. And so it was like something I was just
drawn to. Yeah, yeah.
I was, you know, mesmerized by it. And so in high school, I played with the idea of wanting to go to culinary school.
Okay.
And that's what I wanted to do. Cause I was like, oh, you want to be a chef? You want to go to culinary school. And at the time, being a chef was not necessarily the most viable career path.
No.
And
definitely
it was
not.
Like almost seen as kind of like this underbelly
behind
the curtain of the hospitality industry.
Mm-hmm.
And my parents being very old school and kind of maybe not necessarily closed-minded, but just wanted to make sure I had options.
Yeah.
We're like, oh, you know, maybe it's not what you think. Maybe you just like cooking, but you don't actually want to work
in
a restaurant sort of thing. So go to a university, get a degree.
Uh-huh.
And that way you have something to fall back on, which is like kind of funny and ironic, I guess, now, because it's like so many people are like, degrees are worth nothing.
Yeah, like, and they're falling back on cooking.
Yeah. People are falling back on cooking, which is so funny that that's the way things have, you know, turned around. But so that's what I did. I skipped culinary school, went to UC Davis. I got my bachelor's degree. And I'm so, you know, even with student loan debts, I'm thankful and happy I did that path.
For sure.
Because there's so many things I learned, about, you know, managing teams and communicating with people and just life experiences.
Yeah.
That I got there that I wouldn't, you know, trade or exchange for anything else.
Your kitty's so nice.
Yeah. He's very friendly.
So where do you go to college?
I went to UC Davis.
Okay.
So that's Northern California. Davis is like a small college town.
Mm-hmm.
I want to say it's only maybe like
a lot of farm business over there.
It's surrounded by farms.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
It's one little town surrounded by farms. You're maybe 30 minutes from Sacramento.
Yeah.
And the only people who live there essentially are the students, the professors, and like a handful of like old timers that have always lived.
Got you. So it gets like a little wild over there. Families
and like, but they like being kind of surrounded in that bubble. It's very much a bubble.
Got you.
It is a bubble.
Okay. Is it a party bubble or?
They're definitely. I don't. You know, I don't have anything to compare it to. You know, I'm sure it's not like ASU or UCSB. Like everybody knows those as like the party schools on the West Coast. Then we definitely partied. I was in the Greek system.
Okay.
So that
okay.
kind of like definitely influenced the amount of partying I did.
Yeah, yeah.
But I don't think it was like a party school. A lot of people were there to learn. And that's like, you know, that was my priority there as well.
Oh, yeah. So during college, did you have jobs?
So the first year or so, I didn't.
Okay. Because
I was getting acclimated.
Yeah, yeah.
I didn't want to take that on. But we had what's called the coffee shop or the coffee house. The coffee house. If you know Davis, you've heard of the coffee house.
Okay.
It is, it's like an institution. It's so much more than a coffee house. It's a student run, eatery in the middle of campus. That is a, like multiple coffee shops, multiple little bakery, grab and go sandwiches, wraps, a hotline, pizza counter, like kind of like a Tex-Mex counter. All the different foods you could think of. And I think they just celebrated their 50th year anniversary, I don't know, maybe 8 years ago or so.
Okay.
So they've been around a long time. It's an institution. They employ a huge number of students on campus. And so, obviously, cooking, I was like, oh my gosh, what a great place to get a job. Got a job there and worked part-time there while I was going to school. To be exposed to it. And it was not by any means a restaurant. It was a bunch of kids.
Having fun.
Having fun, food, playing music, making tuna salad, and like having a good time. But nonetheless, I fell in love with it. I was like, this is awesome.
Yeah.
I want to be around this. I excelled very quickly. I went from just, you know, a prep cook to one of the kitchen supervisors in a short period of time. So I was like, okay, I'm good at this.
Yeah.
I have the eye for detail. This is something I definitely want to pursue outside this.
For sure. Okay. So then after school, right, where do you go from there?
After school, was challenging in the sense of figuring out kind of what to do.
Yeah.
Because still, even at this time, we're talking 2010, being a chef was not still something necessarily that you could proclaim from the mountaintop.
Exactly.
As, like, I'm successful. Yeah. I'm a chef. So I have a degree and I have kind of this internal struggle of like, what is my friends, my family, people going to think of me if I don't use this degree that I just spent all this time, all this money doing? But I ignored all of those like kind of internal negative thoughts about what other people might think of me or, and wanted to get a job in a restaurant. San Francisco was kind of like the place to go at the time. I mean, it still is. But I couldn't get a job there. I didn't know the industry. I didn't know the way it worked. I didn't really even know like how to apply other than filling out an application online. And that's not really how you get a job in a kitchen back
then. Yeah, for sure.
So through a friend of a friend, I got put in touch with someone that was opening a restaurant in Ukiah.
Okay.
Which, you know, Ukiah?
Yeah.
Small town, about 3 hours north of San Francisco.
Yeah.
Maybe a little further. Not much else around there. And so I was like, okay, let's do it.
Yeah, let's do it.
Let's do it.
Okay.
Move to Ukiah. Why not? And so I it was like me, my cat, U-Haul, got a little apartment, little one bedroom apartment in Ukiah. And showed up for like the first day of work. And it was this huge operation.
Okay.
Like something that now looking back on it, I don't know how that came to fruition, but it was like a steakhouse, bakery, butcher shop, all in one, out in a bar that had a sports bar attached. And it was like everything, this huge, huge operation. Had to have been a lot of money put into it for the build out in this tiny little town where like the biggest competition is Applebee's across the street. There are no other like restaurants per se.
Okay.
And so I took that job, started as a line cook, quickly got promoted to a sous chef. But was learning everything. I didn't know anything about actually cooking. Everything I learned up to that point was like watching Good Eats.
Yeah.
Like reading cookbooks. you know, that like Good Eats was like my, my culinary school.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
I watched like Alton Brown growing up, like over and over. I like knew all his techniques, all of his thought processes, like why he did certain things. And that became like, okay, I at least know this much about
it. Yeah.
This is what I know. And so using that and kind of picking up things on the job every day, talking to the other people that were there.
Mm-hmm.
And quickly saw a lot of like, well, this doesn't seem right. And I learned kind of what not to do.
Exactly.
In a restaurant, mm-hmm. the way business maybe shouldn't be run or things you shouldn't do in a kitchen. But I took that as a learning experience. I was like, okay, like I'm seeing it. Clearly, this probably isn't the right way to do things, but at least it's a way to do things.
Yeah.
And I was like, okay, this isn't really going anywhere. I need to figure out my next moves. And fortunately enough, there was a guy, an older gentleman. He'd been a chef. He owned restaurants at one point in his life. He'd been through a lot.
Yeah.
And kind of almost saw me, I guess, as a son.
Okay.
And was like, Joe, you need to, sat me down one day, Joe, you need to get out of here. You need to go to San Francisco. This place is going nowhere.
Yeah.
Who knows when it's going to close or something's going to happen. And he saw talent in me and was like, you need to go get another job. And I was like, well, I don't know how. Nobody will let me in the door because I have no experience.
Yeah.
I don't have, everybody wants 2 or 3 years experience. And this might, I had maybe like 6 months, 8 months experience. And he's like, okay, this is what you're going to do. Put my name down. He had like a house number, a cell phone number, and like another cell phone number. He's like, put down all my numbers on your resume. We'll make up names of restaurants. And if anyone calls me, I'll say you worked for me and say that you're awesome. He's like, you need to get out here. And I was like, okay, like that makes sense. And so I used that. My resume now looked like I had a few years of experience.
Yeah.
Went to the city and immediately was able to find a job. Found a restaurant, got my foot in the door. I don't think anyone ever called him. I mean, I don't know about you. I rarely call references.
No.
Like, that's not something you necessarily do. When I'm the chef of a place, I'll text a colleague.
Yeah, exactly.
Somewhere he's worked, but you're not going to call
him. Demeanor in general.
Right. I don't know how other industries work.
Exactly.
For those of you listening that don't know, it's not necessarily something that's very common to call references.
No, hell no.
In the restaurant industry. Mm-hmm. And so I got a job at Michael Mina's RN74.
Okay.
Which was like a French brasserie.
Okay. Sort of thing. Did you have to stage?
I think I might have. God. I want to say I did.
Okay.
Yeah, I did.
Got you.
I stopped.
Now, when you moved from Ukiah to San Francisco, how big of an endeavor was that?
That was a big leap. I got a U-Haul. I packed it myself. I was lucky in the sense I didn't have to search very far and wide for a place.
Okay.
Which I didn't know at the time how hard housing was in San Francisco.
Yeah.
But I mean, it also too, I think it was a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 bedroom house with maybe 8 people living in it.
Okay. You and your buddies or just room share Craigslist?
Craigslist family.
Okay. Heard.
And so like 2 of the guys were friends. They had lived there a long time. And a lot of the people had been there a while. One person was leaving. So, like, I just... I remember I did the interview, the house interview. So okay. You got to go and meet the people.
Yeah.
And you got to interview with them. And one of the things I remember he told me afterwards, because we became friends, we're still friends.
Yeah.
Which I might be fair, I don't know. They were talking and they were playing Halo.
Okay.
On Xbox.
Yeah.
And I was not a huge video game person. I didn't have time for that. I worked in a restaurant.
Yeah.
And he was like, oh, we play Halo all the time. I was like, oh my God, Halo. I love Halo. Favorite video game.
This is
and I was like, oh yeah, Halo tournaments. We could play Halo together all the time. And this guy Dan got so excited that a fellow Halo player.
Yeah.
That bumped me to the top of the potential interview list. And so I was able to get in. And then when we got there, like, you know, a couple weeks go by. He said, when are we going to play Halo? I was like, I don't really play
Wow.
And it became like an ongoing joke, like the whole time. He's like, man, Joe, every time I see him, he's like, man, if only we played Halo together.
That's fun.
So that's kind of how I landed then in San Francisco. And it was a grind.
Yeah.
I mean, like, you know, it's a grind, especially at that age. And I feel like it's almost a different time now, where it'd be much harder for a young cook to do the same thing that I did.
Oh, for sure.
Because you can't work for free anymore, even if you just want to learn.
Yeah.
Number of reasons. I mean, people get taken advantage of, and so there are now laws and protections in place looking out for those people that do get taken advantage of.
Yeah.
But it becomes very hard then for people that want to just better themselves.
Yeah.
and learn and put in the time. So I was showing up hours early for my shift, yeah. staying later hours early for my shift, off the clock, but because I wanted to, and I had no problem with that. Like, yeah. I wanted to learn. I was, like, hungry for knowledge. I wanted to see things. I wanted to be exposed to things. I wanted to see how the fish was broken down. I wanted to see how the meat was broken down. Yeah. I wanted to see. I wanted to learn. I wanted to touch. And, like, it's crazy now thinking kind of how far just everything has changed in the past 10 years.
Yeah.
It's very, very hard for a young man to do that same sort of grind.
Yeah.
Which is, I don't want to say it's unfortunate. It's just different. And it's like, I don't know how then other people can learn that same way. Because it's harder than now. No, I'm a business owner. I totally understand the flip side of it. You can't have people working for you.
Yeah, exactly. The clock.
Like, that's screwed up. Mm-hmm. Like, there are so many liability issues.
But exactly.
The world was a different place back then. So
yeah.
I was able to kind of do that.
I wonder how the knowledge is going to be transferred.
You know, funny, I think a lot of knowledge these days, I don't know if it's, I don't think it's sadly, but virtually,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
is really like yeah. where everybody's transferring knowledge and learning. And then, okay, so you don't spend the extra hours in the kitchen, you spend extra hours on YouTube.
Yeah.
I don't know if that translates to the same thing.
Yeah.
It probably doesn't. It does to an extent, you know, you're not learning to cut tape or put labels on
yeah.
at home.
Mm-hmm.
It's something you would learn in a restaurant, but you can still learn a lot of technique and ways to do things.
For sure. What were you doing at this restaurant, Amina's?
So I started as a fish entremet.
Okay.
So that is the person.
Right on the hotline.
Fish entremet, cooking the side dishes, the sides and veggies that went with the fish course.
Got you.
So. It was a small hotline, but a lot of people on it. There was the fish cook, the fish entremet, the meat cook, the
meat entremet, okay.
And the oven. And the oven did like escargot,
okay.
bone marrow and all like mm-hmm. the French things, a place. And so I just got thrown in the thick of it.
Okay.
And the two cooks next to me were, at the time, I thought I knew they were strong cooks.
Yeah.
They had held themselves to a high standard. They held me to a high standard. And they've gone on and done great things with their careers.
Yeah.
So it's like, I was surrounded by good people at the time.
Okay.
Which I think makes a huge difference.
Oh, for sure.
Because it's like, they're not letting little things slip.
Mm-hmm.
And so I remember getting so frustrated for weeks learning how to make a butter, like how to glaze turnips.
Mm-hmm.
And the idea of like emulsifying water and butter on a vegetable in a pan,
mm-hmm.
I just couldn't wrap my head around it. I never learned. I didn't understand it. I was never taught. And every time I passed up the turnips in the pot and the pan, it was either too much liquid and they'd like pour it out.
Yeah.
And go on to like on one of those little trays, the seafold.
With the seafold, yeah.
With the seafold and let all the extra butter water drain. Or it was the other way where the glaze was broken and they were like shiny and not glazed. And I just couldn't figure it out. And then I remember the day it clicked. And I was like, oh, this is what glazing is. And you kind of get an eye for it. You see the pan. You see the way it's bubbling.
Yeah.
And sometimes it's literally like a drop of water or just like half a second back on the heat.
Yeah.
Brings the glaze back together or fixes it. And they wouldn't let it slide ever, which pushed me to have that same standard to learn. To get better at it. And once I did, I just remember that being like, I finally learned how to glaze a vegetable.
Yeah. And you get frustrated.
So frustrated.
Like when they just give you the turns back. Nope.
Yep.
Try again.
Try again. Do it again.
And the craziest part about that is that they're holding up the entire service.
Right.
It's not like this is the only thing we're cooking. There's 40 plates behind 40 that.
40 other plates. There's duck on the plate.
Exactly.
Steak is getting cut.
Things are getting cold.
Scallops are waiting.
Yeah. And then everybody's looking at you like, you can't glaze the turnip, dude.
Glaze the turnip.
That internal, like, fuck you guys. You know, that shit will make you better.
It will.
100%
of the
time.
The perseverance to do it.
For sure. Because at the end of the day, when you have that beer, you don't want to be the guy that can't glaze the turnip.
Yep.
You know?
You want to be able to hold your head high.
Exactly. Exactly.
And be proud of every single plate that mm-hmm. you put out. I mean, it's like probably one of the most cliche sayings, but you're only as good as your last plate.
Oh, for sure. That's 100%.
But it's true.
Yeah.
You know, if you put up something as your last play, that's not, you can't be proud of.
Yeah. You're not proud of it. They're not proud of it. And then, you know, you always hang on to that. Like, if you fucked up glaze, you take that home with you. You know, like, fuck, I fucked up the glaze. You get that next day to make it up. But if then you fuck it up again, and you're like, God damn it, you know? But then after a while, the same thing just falling on your face over and over again.
Yeah, it's like, those mistakes that define you. I mean, it defined me in the way where I would get so in my head about it. I would never want that mistake to happen again.
Exactly.
So I became, like, obsessed over learning how to do something, making sure I only made a mistake one. I remember one time I oversold scallops. I didn't have a count on
those. Oh, scallops. That's the worst.
And that was when I had moved out to fish roast.
Yeah.
So I was the one cooking the fish. And I didn't, like, we're just grinding. Like, this restaurant, we
that's do horrible.
300 covers a night. And, you know, the board is full. We're cruising, going through service. Orders are coming in, and I'm not keeping track of anything. Yeah. I'm just cooking. And when you're a cook, you can't just cook. You have to be aware of everything around you. And I realized partway through, like, my little third pan of scallops was diminishing.
Yeah.
I had a ton of tickets on the board.
How many scallops?
Yeah, how many scallops do we need? I have 5 orders left. We have, like, 10 on the board. And I just remember the look of disappointment in the chef's face.
Yeah.
Because now he has to tell the server has to go face the diner. And it's just—it's not just on me.
Yeah.
It's on everyone.
It's on everybody.
You make everyone look bad. Yeah.
It's like, yeah.
Because we ran out of scallops.
Exactly.
And it's like, it could have been avoided if I had. And I mean, maybe even at the time, I was new and younger. I didn't even realize maybe I should have been counting scallops.
Exactly.
I mean, so that's like part of like learning on the job, but also like. You learn. You do that once. I did that once.
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever since that time. So I felt so bad.
Yeah.
I like couldn't sleep. I like the next day I came in. I like apologized again to the chef. I was like, oh my gosh, like it'll never happen again. Like, you know, to the point where you like feel sick to your stomach and you like it almost makes a tear to your eye.
Yeah.
You're like, care so much.
For sure. And you never know, that diner who ordered the scallops could have been their birthday.
Right.
It could have been their favorite thing to eat. And now they can't get that thing.
Now they can't get it.
And you fucking ruined their birthday.
Now you're making me feel bad all over.
It's all good.
It's been years.
It's all good.
I can't forget about the scallops.
So how long did you end up working at that restaurant?
I think I was there for maybe almost 3 years, perhaps.
Okay.
Something like that.
So did you get to the meat station at all?
I ended up taking over at, I was almost, I don't even know if we had an executive sous chef at the time, but I was almost in that kind of position where I was able to, I was running a whole kitchen.
Ordering,
bouncing around, training, interviewing, working with new hires.
Gotcha.
And so I left after that. And the reason I left was it was a great exposure to dining and cooking.
Yeah.
And cooking refined French food. But we're doing it in crazy high numbers.
Yeah.
We do 300 covers plus like 80 people in the private dining room. And some nights it was just like grueling in the sense where food just had to go out and it wasn't as perfect as you wanted it to be.
Yeah.
But it just had to go. It just, the way the world worked, you know? And I hated it. I didn't like that. I wanted to be able to be, every plate be perfect.
Yeah, for sure.
And so I needed to take a break because I just got so burnt out doing that. And I realized I'd never been to Europe. So my brothers had just graduated college. They're a couple years younger than me. They're twins.
Okay.
And they just graduated college and was like, all right, like, you guys want to go to Europe? So we got backpacks, booked tickets to Europe, and spent 8 weeks traveling around Europe.
Awesome. Where'd you go first?
We flew into London, spent some time there, took the train to Paris.
Oh, badass.
Rented a car in Paris. I had to learn to drive stick shift in the parking lot of the rental car.
On the other side of the fucking car.
On the other side of the car. Because they only have stick shift cars.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a rental car, so I didn't have to worry about burning out the clutch.
Yeah, there you go.
Drove down to like Lyon, went down to the south of France. We stayed in Biarritz.
Okay.
It's like an incredible little hidden oasis in each town.
Whoa.
On the coast. Drove over into San Sebastian. Over to Barcelona, then hopped on a plane to Italy, did the whole Bologna, Pisa, Florence, Naples, Rome, did I say that? And then flew up, and we were like, okay, now let's fly up to Germany. Did Berlin, Prague, Amsterdam, And then by that point, we were burnt out.
Trip of a lifetime, man.
8 weeks of nonstop going.
Yeah, with your brothers. Like, that must have been so cool.
It was really cool. And it's crazy because it would be such a different trip if I did it again.
Yeah.
Now.
Yeah.
I was just at a different point in my life. You know, I liked food. We all liked food and eating. Grew up in the same household. But food wasn't my life at that point. I really enjoyed it. And so, like, we weren't necessarily looking for the best restaurants or hidden gems or, like, you know, we were staying at hostels and looking for, like, a place to drink or a place to get something cool to eat and, like, going out exploring the city. So I look forward to going back to a lot of those places again now as me.
Yeah.
Now that I, like, really know who I am and what I care about and having a whole new experience. And I feel like it's almost going to be like visiting a lot of these cities for the first time, even though I've already been there years ago. So I'm excited for that kind of thinking to the bright and sunny future.
Yeah, hell yeah. So after those 8 weeks, you come back.
I came back, and now I'm back in San Francisco, and I wanted to find the next place to work.
Okay.
And at that point, while in Europe, I learned about Michelin stars. We had eaten at Trogrill.
Okay.
So, like, I had my first three Michelin star meal. Which was, like, life-changing in the sense, like, oh, my God, this is, like, we've got the kitchen tour. I was like, wow, shiny. Like, what a brigade.
You're so like, intense. They look so good. Everyone's beautiful in here.
Everything is beautiful, like, polished. And so, came back, and I was like, all right, I need to get a job at Michelin star restaurant.
Yeah.
Like, that's the only way I'm going to get better. I wanted to do tweezer food, putting everything perfect on the plate, and not doing over 100 covers a night.
Yeah.
So those are kind of, like, what I wanted to find.
The parameters.
And I stopped at a couple of places, and they all just, nothing excited me or challenged me in the way I felt I needed to be.
Yeah.
And then I ended up getting a stage at Quince.
Okay.
At the time, they had one Michelin star. And everyone I talked to, all my friends and colleagues in the city were like, you do not want to work there. And I was like, why? Like, it seemed great. It was like an intense system. It was like crazy day of staging. And everyone was like, it's just, they're tough. It's hard. It's grueling. It's one of the hardest kitchens to work in the city. Like, people just don't come out of there alive. Like, they were making it sound like it was just this intense place. And I was like, perfect.
Yeah, that's exactly what that sounds great to me.
That's where I want to be. I want that.
Yeah.
I need to be exposed to that. And so when I went back for the like final interview and like to get the job offer, they didn't have anything at night as a cook. But they had like an AM position at Catonia, their sister restaurant next door.
Okay.
Doing pasta fillings, pasta doughs, butchery. And kind of just getting production going.
Yeah.
And I was like, all right, I'll take it. Yeah. Sure. Because then I was on the fast track for a night position. Because apparently those don't open very often. And everybody wanted to work there.
You get to learn everything else.
And I get to learn the other side of it. I was like, I don't know butchery. I'd love to learn.
Exactly.
I don't know how to make pasta fillings. That sounds cool. So I did that. And I was maybe doing that for 3 or 4 months.
Okay.
Which were incredibly long days as well, just because I wanted to learn, riding my bike to and from work every day, freezing cold in the morning, doesn't matter if it's raining. Because you're not going to spend money on a cab, you're not going to spend money on a lift, like, you're grinding by to do this. It's not a high-paying job at all, you're not getting all the overtime hours, or, you know, you're just doing because you love it and you want to learn. And then one night I was getting ready to leave. I was saying goodnight to the chef at Quince, like shaking out with everyone. And I'd maybe been there since 6 a.m. Around 6 p.m., I was getting ready to go. Service was just getting started. And I don't remember what the meat entremet did, but something so egregious. And he essentially got thrown out of the kitchen.
Gotcha.
Right as service was beginning.
Heard that.
The chef, I was like right there in the moment, the chef took that guy's apron, turned around, handed it to me, and said, great, you're working tonight. And all of the emotions, like my whole stomach flipped.
Yeah.
Because obviously that had been what I wanted to do, what I was going towards. I was not mentally prepared for that. I was terrified. Some guy had just gotten kicked out for messing up.
Yeah.
Here I am. I have no idea. I'm not trained for this. I've never cooked at this level. I don't know. Like, I started questioning everything I knew. I was like freaking out. But then that first night, one of the sous chefs hung out with me on the station the whole time.
Okay.
He essentially cooked, and I was just kind of like his extra set of hands.
Yeah.
Helping him out. But that then became, now, okay, I'm no longer a prep cook. Now I'm a line cook at night. And that kind of started then the whole next leg of my journey at Quinn's.
Whoa. So I think, I mean, as soon as he gave you that apron, just the fact that you took it and put it on and said, okay, then I think you were in. You know,
I was in.
At that point, yeah. It's usually just to see, like, okay, is this guy going to... The same thing happened to me at Meadowood. It's like, guy was on Garmage. Chef's like, get the fuck out of here. Looks at me, he's like, get on Garmage or you're fired.
Right.
And I was like, yes, sir.
And you're either right? Going to do it or
exactly.
You're
not. Exactly. Yeah.
It's like sink or swim. You throw it in the deep, throw him in the deep end.
Yeah.
Does he come back to the surface?
100% of the time, do it and try to float. It'll be all right. And then, so Quint starts for you.
Quint starts for me. And there, thinking back on it, it was the hardest time of my life, my career. Every single day was the hardest day.
So those guys were right.
Everybody was
yeah,
right.
Yeah.
And it wasn't just like the environment. It wasn't necessarily because like people were yelling.
Yeah,
it was like it tough. It's just like every aspect about it was hard. We were pushing for that second star.
It's tough food.
The food was hard. Yeah. The menu would change every day to the point where, like, I didn't understand it at the time. Now as a chef, I totally get it because I could be the same way. Mm-hmm. But we'd be prepping a dish. You know, you get there at 9 or 10 a.m., you start your prep, mm-hmm. you know what's on the menu. All of a sudden, one of the chefs gets back from the farmer's market at 1,
it's like,
we just got this awesome stuff. Get rid of everything you just did.
It's on your station.
We're going to start this new dish tonight instead. And I couldn't wrap my head around that.
Yeah.
I was like, what do you mean a new dish? We didn't, like, prep anything.
Yeah.
We didn't test it. We didn't plan it. No. Like, just make this, make a puree, make a powder here, use that, cut these, glaze them, cook this, and you'll be good to go. You're good by 5, right? And you're just, there's no other answer other than yes, chef.
Yeah, exactly.
And so being in that sort of environment every single day where you don't know what's going to happen,
mm-hmm.
every day is a roller coaster ride of emotions, of fears, of anxiety, of excitement. And so that kind of then shaped how I became as a cook. I became very detail-oriented, very disciplined, very much able to adapt and think on my feet.
Yeah.
And try not to get upset about like little things that can easily get you upset.
Oh, yeah. Throw a wrench in your day.
Every day there's just a wrench. And from like, you know, we have maybe one blender for the entire restaurant that sometimes we've had to share with Catonia next door.
Oh!
So it's like people would have all of the components of the 4 purees they have to make in delis. Already cooked, waiting to puree with like a line for the blender.
Yeah.
And just little things like that. Then like after you leave and go work somewhere else, anything else is easier.
Yeah.
Nothing is as hard as those days.
And you get to the place that has 2 blenders. And you're like, what the fuck are you guys bitching about?
Yeah, uh-huh. This is great.
Yeah, exactly.
You have 2 blenders and they both work?
Yeah. Like, 4 blender tops? Where do you get them?
Yeah.
You're like, what is this? Man. So what stations did you graduate from the one that you started at?
So I did Meat Entremet,
mm-hmm.
and then I think I did Meat Roast for a little bit. I did Fish Entremet for a little bit. And then kind of that same serendipitous progression, I was thrown onto the pasta station for almost the same reason.
Okay.
Pasta cook got fired or asked to leave. And they needed someone. I was maybe an extra set of hands that night, or I don't even know how I got pushed over there.
Yeah.
And funny enough, like, Quint's at the time, probably still, is known for their pasta. Cooks were coming from all over the world to stage there, to spend time there, to try to get a job there, to hopefully get to make pasta and learn from Chef Tusk.
Uh-huh.
And that was not on my radar at all. I was like, I just want to cook tweezer food, refined food, play things nice. And I don't care about pasta. I grew up eating pasta. Like, oh, I hate pasta.
Yeah. Man. You're like, come on. Get out of here, bro.
Yeah. And I was just like, I didn't get it. I didn't understand it.
Yeah.
I didn't necessarily care. I was like over it, pasta, from being exposed to it my whole childhood. And so I got pushed onto the pasta station. And little did I know that would be another one of those defining moments in my career, in my life.
Yeah.
That now, not a day goes by where I don't think about cook, make, or eat. Cost.
Yeah, got you. So You get put on this pasta station. Are you working with Tusk directly?
So the pasta station is two cooks.
Okay.
It's a two-team station. One person usually does, like, Phil pasta. The other person does, like, the ribbon noodle.
Okay.
And sometimes there were, like, four, well, in the beginning, there were maybe four pastas on the menu, so it was, like, two and two dishes.
Uh-huh.
Like, two dishes to worry about. But we had a pasta team of people that would make pasta in the mornings for you.
Okay.
And so you'd write on the prep list or the request list, like, hey, I need 300 tortelli, I need 200 agnolotti, I need 80 orders of tag. And some days they would finish it all, and some days they wouldn't. And the days that they wouldn't, you were still responsible for having those orders. So once again, you know, you come in early because you can't sleep.
Yeah, exactly.
You're like, well, up at 6 a.m., anxiety, like, am I going to have my mise en place for tonight?
Yeah, this is 12 hours from now, right? Yep. 6 a.m., uh-huh. 6 o'clock service. It's crazy how much that shit affects you.
And so I would come in early, and the whole pasta team only spoke Spanish.
They got you.
Speak yep. English, and I didn't speak Spanish, but I did enough, and they spoke enough English to where pasta became the language for us.
Yeah,
so I would
sure.
hang out with them in the morning,
yeah,
and spend the first couple hours of my day helping them make the pasta
mm-hmm.
to make sure I had my pasta for that night. But at the same time, learning, you know, we try to ask questions. How does this dough look? Is it right? And mojado, seco. Is it dry? Is it wet? and like just little things that I was learning about pasta from people who didn't speak English, and pasta was that language.
Yeah.
Which is crazy. And so Tusk would occasionally spend time teaching pasta to us. Most rememberably, or I guess significantly, was the tortellini.
Yeah.
So he had just come back from Italy. I guess this is fast forward now. So yeah. I learned pasta. I'm on the pasta station. I'm in it to win.
Yeah.
Now
yeah.
it's like every day. I want pasta. I want to make it. I need to make sure my station's set. I have all the stuff I need. I have the tools, and I'm just pushing to get every day better and learn more. And then he comes back from a trip to Italy, where he spent time in Bologna at the laboratories of pasta,
uh-huh.
where, you know, the nonas, the grandmas, the women, all in like the pink garbs, just spend all day making tortellini, all by hand. Fatto a mano. And so he comes back and he's like, we're going to do this here.
Yeah.
And we have pasta machines. We have sand mixers. And he's like, nope, we're going to do it like they did there. The way I learned it. No machines, only a rolling pin. I brought some mozzarella back, big wooden rolling pins. And I'm going to teach you how to do it all by hand. And so we have to knead the dough by hand. We have to sheet the dough by hand. I learned how to roll big sfoglias, which was a huge learning curve in itself.
Yeah.
And then that became the only dish on my station was tortellini. It was tortellini and like buttercream with Parmesan and truffle.
Because that's how long it would take to make these tortellinis.
It was eight. I remember still specifically, it was 18 pieces per order. We did about 80 orders a night.
Jesus, man.
And so, and I couldn't use a machine. And so that then became my new stressor.
Yeah.
My new anxiety. Exactly. My new obsession.
Yeah.
To then where I would come in every day, I would immediately get my pasta board. I'd carry the big wooden table out to the dining room. I would set it up. I'd have all my dough balls already made from the day before, roll out the dough, and just stand there cranking on tortellini.
Yeah.
Come back into the kitchen around 4:30, you know, blend my fondue, my cheese sauce.
Yeah.
And be ready for service. And I make that sound very simple, easy, but the stress level of making sure you have enough tortellini has never been
high. Yeah.
There were nights where I would be looking into my low boy, looking at the clock, looking at the ICO, like how many covers are left to go.
Yeah.
And counting down the individual pieces. Like, chef,
am I going to make it?
I have exactly enough orders. You sure no one else is coming to?
Yeah, exactly.
Otherwise, we need to make more pasta right now.
Yeah.
And so, like, there were just moments like that that just crazy.
Yeah.
And because we were cooking at such a high level, that is not something you ever run out of. It's not like the scallops.
Yeah.
Where it's like, oh, sorry, we're out tonight. People are coming from all over the world. These are all special occasion dinners.
Yeah.
These are all a big deal. And every single diner needs to have it as if this is the only time in their life they're ever going to eat here.
Yeah.
There's no second chances.
Heard that.
And so that tortellini became everything for me. And that was something I learned directly from Tuss.
Mm-hmm. Gotcha. Wow. The tortellini.
The tortellini.
Do you still make it to this day?
I still make it to this day. I make it the same exact way. I went as far. I have my I have two tattoos. My only other tattoo is Fatu Alana I have on my arm.
Yeah.
From rolling out, making dope
so
every
many.
Single day.
That's for, so many.
It had to have been at least 8 months straight that was on me.
Yeah.
The only thing I did.
I remember that anticipation when you're like asking your chef, you're like, all right, how many per order? Please yeah. say, please
how
say
many
six.
Per order? And then there would be the
yeah,
next.
You know, 18.
Where VIPs would come in at Katonia next door, yeah. and the kitchens are, the restaurants are connected in the back.
Yep.
So it's like you walk right to the other one. Tells would come over and be like, oh, fired, you know, 8 orders of tortellini. I have some VIPs next door, and pull out one of these giant copper serving dishes. And it's like, just fill it up.
Oh.
And you just, your head sinks. You're like, okay. The one day you thought you were maybe ahead and you don't have as many to make tomorrow. Nope.
Never.
Never ahead. Always behind.
It's the pasta cook lesson everywhere. Whenever you think you have enough, just make more.
Make
just
more.
Just make more, bro.
Yep.
Don't do that.
You'll get sold.
Yeah, for sure. For sure.
Go bad.
So, after, how long are you on this pasta?
I was there the whole then time.
Until you left.
Until I left. So I started as one of the pasta cooks.
Yeah.
I got promoted to sous chef. And the way that kitchen was around the brigade we had at that time, every station had its own sous chef.
Heard that.
So there's a meat sous chef, a fish sous chef, a garmze sous chef, pastry sous chef, pasta sous chef, and canapé sous chef.
Okay.
Plus the executive sous chef and the chef de cuisine.
Fuck yes.
So we had a lot of chefs. There was hands everywhere.
Yeah.
It was
eyes and hands everywhere.
Eyes and hands everywhere.
Nowhere to hide.
Right.
Yeah.
And so I was a pasta sous chef. So that became my world.
Okay.
I would oversee the dishes. I was at one point, you know, which was another kind of turning point, I guess, in my career and very meaningful to me, was the first time I was able to put a dish on the menu at Quince. And up until that point, even like the chef de cuisine, Johnny, was like, no one's been able to do pasta. I'm so glad to have you. Tusk is the only one that puts pastas on the menu.
Yeah.
Because he won't let anyone else. And I remember the night he was like, okay, yeah, we can put this on the menu. And I was like, whoa.
You're like, whoa.
One of my dishes.
You've been knighted.
Man, you get knighted.
Yeah.
You get knighted. Speaking of being knighted, cooking risotto is a knighted, ordained process at Quince.
Okay. Yeah. They did it for 12 days.
And oh, they brought, and I'm sure he had a specific risotto cook.
And he had a guy. Yeah.
The guy that's the only one allowed to touch risotto.
Okay. So how does risotto work in that restaurant?
So risotto is always cooked to order.
Uh-huh.
Never blanched or par cooked.
Yep.
And it's a supplemental course. So you don't know if you're going to sell it or when you're going to sell it. But you hear get ordered in.
Yep.
And it's normally selling. There's, at the time, there's maybe three people in the restaurant that were allowed to cook it. There was like the pasta cook who's like ahead of me. I guess had been there longer.
Yeah.
She's the one who taught me with Tusk. There's Tusk, and then maybe one of the chefs was allowed to cook. And so anytime that order came in, you had to then time when to start it.
Mm-hmm.
So it was done 8 courses into the
night. Yeah. Perfectly on time.
Perfectly on time. And the risotto didn't wait.
No, it
doesn't
wait.
Once it starts, it's 13 minutes, plus or minus 2 minutes, and it has to go. If the guest is up from the table, it's like a bomb went off.
Fuck,
like the end of the world.
Yeah.
Where is the
That's
guest?
The worst.
Why are they in the bathroom?
When you finish it, you're
back?
Like, it's perfect.
It's
they're
perfect.
Up, and you're like,
Right. Freak out. But you learn this whole process, and he was so specific about the way the rice had to be toasted, the way the onions had to be cut, the way that you deglazed the pan, the way that you added stock, the temperature, the type of pan you used. You're only allowed to use certain pans that we had in the restaurant, pots. You can only use a certain spoon. Like, so many rules. You couldn't break. Otherwise, you were done.
Yeah.
Toast. Like, don't even try.
Yeah.
And so you have your timers. And some nights you'd have like 8 orders of risotto going. You have the whole side of your
flat top.
Eight different pots.
Different
you have little
times.
Pieces of tape on each one. Table 32, four orders table. 82, sick, like all the orders. And then that's not all you're cooking. You still have your other two pasta dishes you're plating for every timer.
Mm-hmm.
So there's just a lot of things going on. You can only imagine then the stress level. And then Tusk is standing there because he hung out by the pasta station.
Yeah.
And that was his baby.
Just looking at you.
Just standing there. Like, covered. And if you don't know, like, Chef Tusk, he's a big guy.
Yeah, he's a big dude.
Posing, big, broad shoulders.
For sure.
Like, He's not. He's intimidating.
Yeah, you can feel the fucking burning.
You can feel the glare.
Yeah, for sure.
And so, like, you know, he's watching your every move.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't want to disappoint.
No.
You don't
want to be upset.
You don't want to do anything wrong. You want it to be perfect because that's what you're striving for is perfection. Yeah. And so that was risotto, which was a whole another thing. Then I learned there that influenced everything I did. But I guess kind of then shifting out of Quince and what I was doing there, risotto is a good segue into learning another philosophy and mindset on things.
Yeah.
So Quince was my one exposure. I was there for 3 years. We went from 1 to 3 stars. It was huge. Like we were peaking. Like this was awesome. And I remember Mark Vetri came and did his cookbook dinner with us.
Yep.
And he was going to do a risotto on the menu.
Huh.
And Tusk was like, oh, okay, Joe's your guy. He's going to cook risotto with you. He'll cook your risotto, show him how you want it, and he'll cook your risotto all night long. I was so excited. Mark Vetri.
Yeah.
Like, heck yeah, let's do this. I start cooking the risotto. I'm doing it Tusk's way, and he like comes over. He's like, whoa, what are you doing? Stop. Don't do that. That's not how you do it. And like my mind like almost imploded because I thought this was the way. And so Vetri like goes on to explain to me, you know, we're using this special Carnaroli Acquarello rice.
Uh-huh.
It's made and grown and produced in a way that it could stand up to being not cooked the whole time. You don't have to stir it the whole time. You could stop and start it. You could just set it off to the side of the stove and forget about it for 20 minutes and come back to it and it's going to be perfect.
Yeah.
And one thing we had to do in Tusk's version was taste the rice throughout the cooking from the beginning. So you're eating raw rice.
Yeah.
But it's how you learn by eyesight. You see it looks one way, you taste it, you kind of remember that memory.
Mm-hmm.
You see the way it looks 5 minutes into it, you taste it, you have that memory. So then you like know what crunchy rice looks like.
Yeah.
You know what less crunchy rice looks like. I tried to do that with Vetri, and he's like, what the hell's wrong with you? Why would you want to eat raw rice? That's not done.
Yeah.
Like, he wouldn't let me taste it until it was done. And he was like, you got to listen to the rice. The rice is talking to you.
Yeah.
Just listen to it. Just look at it. It'll tell you when it's done. Don't taste it. Who wants to sit here and eat raw rice? What the hell is wrong with you? And I was just so laid back and nonchalant about the whole process. And I just like remember seeing Tusk out of the corner of my eye, like pacing back and forth, like
because
it wasn't being done his way. But you know, he's not gonna say anything.
No,
Vetri is Vetri's dinner. This is how Vetri wants to cook it. And so it was just that was another kind of like very memorable turning point moment. I was like, okay, there are other ways to do things.
Yeah,
and this
exactly.
is the only way.
Mm-hmm.
And neither one is necessarily the right way. They're just two different ways. And so that kind of then was a very memorable, impactful experience being exposed to that.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, okay, I need to get out of here and learn more. You know, 3 years is a long time. There were a lot of changes happening at that time. We were losing our CDC. Our executive sous chef was taking his position. I think another sous chef was leaving. And we had to do... This was crazy. This was, we had to do all the sous chefs, even if you didn't want the position. Tusk, it was kind of a good, I guess, learning experience. You had to do a full tasting menu for him, his wife Lindsay, and the general manager, as if you were applying for that executive sous chef position.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So it was like 3 or 4 canapes, a cold fish, a hot fish, a caviar course, 2 pasta courses, a meat, and you could do dessert if you wanted. And they just wanted to see, I guess, what everyone had.
See what you could do.
Yeah. What you could do. And it wasn't like they gave you time to do this. It was like maybe you come in on your day off.
Yeah.
Prep in the 2 minutes you have, like, in between everything else going on. But that was insane. And, like, but really fun now that I look back on it.
Yeah.
Like, I'm glad they made us do that because then it, like, pushes you to just be creative, to come up with dishes, to kind of do something and step outside of comfort zone,
mm-hmm.
which is important as a cook, as a chef, to not fall into the routine of every day.
Don't be comfortable.
Don't be comfortable. It made us very uncomfortable.
Yeah.
So it was at that time I did real well in the tasting. And Tusk asked if I wanted to be the executive sous chef.
Mm-hmm.
as I was leaving to then be the executive sous chef at Lazy Bear. Mm. So it was kind of a bittersweet.
Got you.
So unfortunate moment where I was kind of letting him down, but at the same time, I was ready to move on.
Yeah. Now, where did Lazy Bear come into the radar?
So Lazy Bear was a newer restaurant in San Francisco.
Yeah, yeah.
They started as a pop-up.
Yeah.
Instagram was just becoming a thing at the time. Mm-hmm. So it was like, you could see kind of what they were posting. We're like, oh, this sounds really cool. This sounds like a really cool dish. That looks cool. You didn't have to like wait and get a cookbook to see what the restaurant was doing.
Gotcha.
You will see it on the internet in real time. But prior to that, you're like, oh, what's 11 Madison Bar doing? I don't know. We have to get the cookbook.
4 years from now.
Yeah. But what are they doing in the French Laundry? I don't know. We got to get the cookbook. Yeah. Go to the bookstore and look.
Yeah.
Like you can't, otherwise you can't like go on your phone and see what they made yesterday. And so it was a different time in that sense. And I was just like, it was almost this like mystique of a restaurant.
Yeah.
People were talking about it. They had just gotten their first star, which made them kind of legitimate.
Yeah.
In the sense that, okay, people are taking them seriously.
Exactly.
They're not just a bunch of guys listening to music, the starters pop up, mm-hmm. having fun, dinner party kind of thing.
Yeah.
But that's what it was. It was a dinner party.
Pop-ups weren't respected.
No.
At that time.
It was a dinner party, and they were having a party every night, but they were doing it really well. And so I had met them. I met the chef, the owner, David, at the market, because I was going to the market regularly.
Gotcha, yeah. That's a big community, the Marin Market.
Uh-huh. And David had thought I was the chef at Quince just because I was the one that was always at the market. And he knew I was with Quince, but he didn't know what I did there or who I was. He just thought, you know, the chef goes to the market. Yeah. I was just a sous chef at the time. But he was like, hey, I'm looking for a new executive sous. Would you be interested? Is that something you want to do? And, you know, I was terrified of leaving. I didn't want to switch jobs, like, you know, comfortability, I guess you could say.
Yeah, for sure.
But he convinced me to come stosh and spend a day there. And I did. And that kind of like then, it was the affirmation that, okay, this is the right change to make.
Yeah.
Because it was everything we were doing at Quince without the fear.
Understood.
Or the anxiety. I mean, yeah. It was anxiety, but it wasn't that like gut-wrenching, I can't make a mistake.
Yeah, yeah.
But they were cooking at a high level. They were pushing. They had standards. Everything like that we were doing in Quince, they were doing Lazy Bear. It just had a different set of clothes.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? And so I was like, all right, like, this sounds really cool. Let's do it. Which I'm so... That is probably my favorite place I've ever worked, mm-hmm. just in terms of like what the experience we were able to create,
yeah,
the systems we had in place. And it was a very much like we were learning every day, getting better.
Yeah.
We were doing something that hadn't been done before. We were doing a dinner party. So we had 40 guests sitting all at once, two big tables of 20, everybody sitting side by side, and everyone eating at once. And so you're doing a fine dining dinner party. You're plating everything at once. It's almost like banquet style.
Yeah.
But you're trying to do high-end cuisine food.
Yeah.
And so we had to figure out systems for dietary, systems for tracking guests, systems for substitution, systems for like alternate menus.
Yeah.
Everyone, even if you're allergic to milk, you still get an awesome meal.
Yeah.
Just with subs, it's not like you don't get the course if there's milk in it or dairy. Yeah. And so we put just as much thought and effort into the vegetarian version, the vegan version, the dairy-free version of all these dishes. And so, one, it pushed creativity. It pushed your ability to think outside of the box. But also, then I saw, like, it wasn't the end of the world if something got screwed up. Like, you still had tomorrow.
Yeah, exactly.
And that was, like, something I learned there very quickly, was, like, you make a mistake, it's okay. Like, still pick your head up. It's fine.
Yeah.
Like, you messed up. Whatever. Let's not do that again.
You're not a piece of shit.
Yeah. Let's not do that again. Yeah,
exactly.
Let's move on. Yeah. Let's just, come on. Don't dwell on that. Like, whatever. Like, don't do it. Mm-hmm. Next time will be better. We have another chance tomorrow. We have another chance later tonight.
Yeah.
Don't screw it up again. And so, like, that whole kind of like shifted then my approach to leading a team, to cooking, to motivating people. That it didn't have to be this like intense,
yeah,
end all be all environment.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that shift was kind of like a huge thing to see and be a part of.
Yeah.
And now that is very much more common in all of the whole industry. Yeah, but at the time, they were very progressive.
Yeah. And it was looked upon as, look at those soft guys over there. Yeah, I know exactly. I had just moved here, you know, a couple of years after I moved here was when all that was going on. And it was like, who are these guys doing their papa? Who do they think they are?
Who do they think they are?
I mean, look where they're at now. That's who the fuck they think they are, you know?
Yeah, so, it was the first year after I was there, we got our second star.
Yeah.
And we had two stars now. And that's when everyone, like, stopped.
Yeah.
And was like, okay, these guys know who they are. These guys are doing it.
Yeah.
And who are we to talk shit anymore? Because
exactly,
they just got two stars from the highest, you know, rating system in our industry, in terms of what people are looking at for affirmation.
Exactly, and doing it like no other. I mean, banquet service, fine dining food.
It's crazy. It's the weirdest concept. Like if you try to say that out loud or write on paper,
exactly. It's like,
and you're like, I need $2 million. And we're going to do banquet style. Yeah. Everyone's going to get the food at once, but it's going to be really
good. Yeah, it's
going
to be real good, I promise. Yeah. That's so awesome. Yeah, shout out to Dave. That's a sick ass piece.
Really awesome.
So, how long were you there?
I was there 2 years.
2 years. And then when did you decide, like, I gotta go?
So, I didn't really even decide I had to go.
Okay.
I would have stayed there.
Okay.
I loved it there. I was happy there.
Yeah.
Things were great. Life was good. I was finally making money to live off of.
Yeah. Yeah.
To the point where
that's a good feeling.
Comfortable. And things were good. And one night, because it's an open kitchen, the way it works is each chef that's responsible for course gets up and talks about it in front of everyone.
Gotcha.
And describes it to the diner, tells them what the dish is all about, the philosophy.
That's great training.
And I did that multiple times tonight because I really like talking to people. And I had my hand in a lot of different parts of the menu. And a lot of the new cooks weren't comfortable.
Yeah.
People who get into cooking aren't necessarily ones that want to be on display.
No.
Shout to an entire room of people.
So when you first get in, and you're like, I'm in the back. No one talks to me.
Right.
But
so that was part of it. And so I would take on that role. And one of the nights, two of the people sitting in the front row were casting producers for Top Chef.
Oh, shit.
Unbeknownst to me.
Yeah.
And the day after they had dinner, they emailed the restaurant. They were like, hey, we want to talk to Joe. Would he ever consider coming on Top Chef? And so they called me, and I was like, no.
Yeah, because at that point, again, it was like, Top Chef. Who the fuck goes on Top Chef?
Who the fuck goes on Top Chef? I had never seen it.
I mean, I'm guilty of that, too.
I was like, bravo. There's, oh, it must just be like the
Yeah,
housewives.
It's like, that's not Food Network.
That's not cooking. That's just a silly show. A bunch of people living in a house, like real world.
Yeah, yeah.
I was like, that's what I thought. And so they called me again, and I was like, no, I'm good. Like, I'm cooking really good food here. Like, I'm happy. I don't need to do that. Really bad.
Yeah.
I thought it would look bad.
Yeah.
I thought all my peers would look down.
You don't want to look like Marcel. You got the shit end of the stick on that one.
She did. And so I said no like three times. And then finally it was my girlfriend, my partner Bella, who was like, why don't you hear them out? Like, maybe this could be good.
It could be good, yeah.
It could be good. They keep asking, why don't you do it? Like, so I got on a plane, went down to LA, did like a round of interviews with the executive producer.
Yeah.
And next thing I knew, they're like, okay, you're booked. You're going to Denver in May.
Whoa.
And I was like, okay, I need to figure out my life.
Yeah.
What I'm going to do. A friend of mine was opening a restaurant in LA that was like a year out.
Okay.
So he was like, why don't you move to LA? You go do Top Chef and then start cooking for me. And I was like, okay, perfect. Everything was kind of falling into place.
Yeah.
And I'm a very much firm believer in, like, everything happens for a reason. Cosmic universe. It all is happening. Everything is lining up. Cosmic alignment. I was able to put in my, like, a good notice at Lazy Bear. Leave on really good terms.
Oh, that's great.
Went down to L.A. The two of us moved to L.A., Bella and I. We were in L.A. for 5 days.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had to get on a plane and leave the Top Chef.
Heard that.
So leaving her alone. In a city.
In a new town, yeah.
New town. We ended up adopting Uni, the cat that was running around.
That was like her very nice.
Support animal as I was leaving.
Heard that.
And I went to Top Chef. And I couldn't have been more wrong about my opinions of the show, the competition, Mm-hmm. The caliber of chefs on it.
The people. Yeah.
The people.
You had a really good cast
here. I had a really good cast, really great talented cast. People, yeah. Really great people. And I had never seen the show before, so I don't want to say we changed it. We were the first ones that were kind to one another. But I know the producers were not happy with the level of camaraderie that we had. To the point where, like, we were checking out Whole Foods and buying ingredients, and someone didn't have enough money to get all their ingredients.
You just buy their
stuff. And we would just buy their stuff. And the producer would be like, what are you doing? They could, like, not have their chicken they need. Yeah, and we're like, why would we want them to not have their chicken?
Yeah, that's a motherfucking, yeah, it's a competition, right? Like, shouldn't they have their shit too?
They need to have their stuff.
That's some cutthroat shit right
and
there,
so,
bro.
So, like, maybe up until that point, like, that was not something they ever saw or dealt with.
Yeah.
But we were very much, like, helping each other out the whole time. Yeah. Some of it made it onto camera, some of it didn't. Because I didn't know how much they probably wanted to show.
Yeah.
It was like, you know, you're packing up everything. Sometimes you're done 10 minutes early, so you go help someone else.
Yeah.
And they were like, well, you sure you want to do that? I'm like, yeah, why not? Like, I have time.
So you're telling me that you just had a series of interviews, like no bench test. Like, nothing. They just sat you down and talked to you.
It was everyone that I've talked to now that I know and I'm kind of like in the inner circle has a very different experience getting on the show.
Gotcha.
So let's put that out there because I get asked relatively often, hey, how do I get on Top Chef? Because now people want to get on the
exactly.
show.
Yeah, exactly.
They see the being
chef. You can apply,
you
right?
Can apply. You can, yeah. And I know, like, without saying names or who did what, some people applied 5 years, every single year. Some people filled out, did, like, handheld camera, talking to the camera, trying to get the producer made, like, an audition tape. Some people got flown out and had to do on-screen camera tests, talking and cooking through recipes. Some people had to do multiple interviews through all the whole range.
Heard that.
And so I didn't. And so that was just my experience. Uh-huh. But I know everyone is very like has a different thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think it just has to do with it's at the end of the day, it's still a show.
Yeah.
People still need to remember there are millions of dollars of marketing value behind this brand, mm-hmm. behind this show.
Yeah.
And as much of a competition reality show, non-scripted, it's still somewhat produced.
Yeah, for sure.
So they know what they want. They know what they need. They know what's going to make a good show.
Mm-hmm.
And so they pull the strings as to who they want there and who they're getting there. And it's not as just like, oh, anyone has the opportunity to do this. It's a show. They need it to be entertaining.
Yeah.
So I think that's what kind of why everybody has a different experience getting on it. They need to make sure they're getting out of each person what they want.
Yeah.
For that season.
Heard that. And do you know the challenges before you go there?
You know nothing.
You know nothing. You just show up.
And I've never seen the show.
Yeah.
So some people I found out had watched every episode.
Yeah. Again, so they know kind of like.
Up to it.
Were they like fanboy? Like fanning out. For like, fucking oh, yeah. Tom uh-huh. shit?
Like, oh my gosh.
I'll tell you what. That part when you guys do the quick fire, whenever Tom comes up to you and says, hey, so what are you doing? He always looks so upset.
It is. I'm glad you see that.
Yeah.
He like peers into your soul.
Yeah, he really does.
And he makes you question, no matter how confident you are in your food, in your dish, and what you're doing, he finds a way to make you feel uncomfortable.
I fucking knew it, dude. I was watching that shit and I'm
that
like,
is his,
look at
his
ability.
Best thing. Like, he's so good at that. No matter how he does it.
Yeah.
No matter what, it can be something you've made 100,000 times. You've gotten accolades for, like, it's like, so he'll come over and be like, you sure you want to be breathing oxygen right now? Like, you're using water. Is that safe?
Yeah.
Is that safe?
Do I like water?
Do I like water? Is that okay? Should I be breathing right now?
Padma, are you okay?
And, oh, he's so good at that.
Yeah.
So good at that.
That's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah. But, I mean, it was a wild ride. As much of a cooking competition it is, it's a mental competition.
For sure.
And people don't realize that, you know, we're all good cooks. We're chefs. We're there.
Yeah.
Under normal circumstances, we could all cook really good food.
Long hours.
But what you don't realize is that you lose control of your life for those 8 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
You have no idea what time you're waking up, what time you're going to sleep, where you're going, where your next direction is, what's behind the door.
So you're all
get
tired
in the car,
as fuck.
It's when you're going to get to eat, when your next break is. Like, you know nothing up until the second it happens. And so that, when you're a chef, that you try to control every aspect of your life, yeah. the day, the restaurant, the mm-hmm. menu. Like, chefs are very hands-on, very controlling kind of personalities. And here we all are with zero control over anything. Like, you don't even know if, like, you have time to go to the restroom. You have to ask. You can't just go.
Okay.
And it needs to, like, fit the production schedule.
And then sometimes they'll be like, no.
Sometimes they're like, no, we just need to get this shot, and then you could go. Or, like, so you don't even, like, you have zero.
Heard that. Zero control. Your life. Yeah, that's wild.
And so that is a huge mental component of competition that nobody realizes.
It seems before they give the verdict of who won the challenges, you guys wait for a long time.
A very long time.
It just, yeah. Because it seems like, people are hammered when they come out to, you know what I mean? It seems like they just put you in a room. They're like, here's cases of wine.
They put you in the stew room. And you know what often happens is because especially if you do an offsite event or you cook in the kitchen, they got to clean it up. And so they got clean. They got to reposition the cameras. Hurt. People need to take their union break.
Uh-huh.
And so there's just a long downtime. And television shows take a long time to make.
Yeah.
They're very long days. You're up at 6 a.m. Sometimes you're going to bed at 1 a.m. And it's just like back-to-back days of nonstop filming. But it's not like you're just nonstop. A lot of it is just spent sitting around waiting for pieces to get put into place.
Uh-huh.
People to arrive, sets to get built. They got to put up all the lighting rigs. They got to put up all the camera rigs. They got to break down all the camera rigs. They got to break down all the lighting rigs. And so there's just a ton of time spent doing nothing, which is another mental hurdle.
Yeah, for sure.
To sit there and do nothing and sit silently. Because you're not allowed to talk. And shit chat and just like shoot the shit.
Yeah.
Because they want to capture every moment on camera. So when the cameras are not rolling, you're not allowed to talk. Mm-hmm. Like you can't just hang
out.
You
can't just hang out. Yeah.
Because what if like we started arguing or what if we started talking about the dish?
Yeah.
Or they want to see that.
Yeah.
And so that's the other, you're just in your head stewing.
Yeah.
Like literally it's called the stew room.
Yeah.
You are stewing in your head. Sometimes good things, sometimes bad things. Second guessing every single move you made. Did I put enough salt? Did I cut it the right direction? Maybe I should have put a little more sauce on the plate. Maybe I should put too much sauce on the plate. And every little thing just weighs on you.
Yeah.
In ways you would have never thought possible.
Wow. So you're filming for 8 weeks.
You're filming for 8 weeks and you're cut off from the outside world.
Yeah.
No,
so you can't call.
No cell phones, TV, internet, music. At one point, maybe like 4 weeks in our house, they gave us a set of DVDs that I think only like one worked. It was Pitch Perfect. And we watched Pitch Perfect.
It almost gave you romantic comedies.
Yeah, it was like romantic comedies. Pitch Perfect. I forget the other ones because I think that was one that was just weird. And the reason we put it on for the most part, too, is because it was music.
Like, oh, yeah.
Radio, listen to music.
Heard that, yeah.
So a lot of it, even though it was a whatever movie, there was songs and sound in it, which then, like, okay, at least you can put it on the background and feel something normal.
Yeah.
But, yeah, it was a wild, wild experience learning a lot, not just about myself, but about my cooking and the things I cared about. And up until that point, I had never been the chef, the number one chef in charge, the executive chef.
Uh-huh.
So normally, like, you know, when you're working on a dish or you're writing a menu, you come up to something, you have a team to talk to, someone else to fall back on, to bounce ideas off of. There you don't. It's just you. And I had never been just me before.
Yeah.
So that taught me a lot about myself, like what mattered to me most, choices and things I had to edit and cut and make kind of like, you don't have time to do everything you want. So you need to choose what matters and what's important and how you want to best represent yourself through food, using food as your voice.
Yeah. Well, so how long did you make it?
The first, that was season 15, the first time I did it. Spoiler alert.
Okay.
I made it to the final three,
uh-huh.
which I was ecstatic about.
Uh-huh.
Super excited. I realized at that time I did the worst dish of the day. So that I wasn't, like, surprised to be going home.
Gotcha.
I knew I'd screwed up.
Yeah.
But then I got to come back and cook the finale meal with Joe Flam.
Oh, cool.
And help him win.
Yeah.
And so, like, we were already good friends at that point. We became best friends at that point.
Yeah.
And it almost felt as good as winning. sure, I didn't get $100,000.
Yeah.
But I felt like I did.
Yeah, I mean, you got the, yeah, that's awesome. And then where did you, after Top Chef, you go back to L.A.?
I was back in L.A., and at this point, I was back working for the MENA Group.
Okay.
Helping them open a restaurant in L.A. It was like a California-Italian concept.
Heard that.
And I didn't know much about L.A. at all, if anything. I was very optimistic
in yeah.
the sense of like, oh, new city, it's California, everything about San Francisco, but L.A. Mm-hmm. I guess I was naive in that sense. L.A. is very different.
Yeah, it's for sure, yeah.
It's its own place. It's its own thing. And I did that for a year and a half,
uh-huh.
about half a year getting ready to open, almost a full year as the executive chef opening the restaurant.
Uh-huh.
And then realized that it wasn't working out for me.
Mm-hmm.
And we had different visions and goals and priorities.
I heard that.
And so we went our opposite ways.
And where did you go from there?
From there, I had the wave of Top Chef.
Okay.
And I was still coming off the top of the crest of this wave.
Uh-huh.
And I wasn't getting the opportunity to pursue that at the restaurant. And I wanted to not let it pass me by.
What kind of wave is that? Is it like special guest dinners and things like that? Guest dinners,
invites to do things, opportunities to be on shows or commercials or branded things.
Yeah.
Kind of like people were just reaching out to me wanting to do more things with Joe Sasso.
Why not, baby?
And I was locked down at the restaurant.
Yeah.
I couldn't. And so I like made a very difficult decision and kind of went out on a leap to blindly trust that I could really pursue that.
Mm-hmm.
And started like with Bella still. We pursued us full time and started doing pop-ups, started traveling, doing pop-up events, doing food and wine events, doing tasting demos, cooking demos, pasta classes.
Yeah.
And that quickly, what we thought would be a couple of months of doing that, quickly turned into 2 years. And we were nonstop during those 2 years. We'd leave, we'd go to a city, we'd fly back to LA. We'd have maybe 16 hours in LA to repack. She'd do laundry, pack, reset the suitcases. I would be in the kitchen prepping for the next dinner, packing the ingredients for the next dinner.
Mm-hmm.
Then we'd fly back out the next morning and fly to the next city and do the next event and the next dinner. And it was awesome.
Yeah.
But incredibly tiring.
Oh, for sure.
To constantly be doing that. And it would, I mean, that, what I just described, I guess to some could sound very glamorous, but it doesn't at all capture or paint the picture of how stressful that is working for yourself. You're grinding. You're an entrepreneur. You're a small business owner in the sense.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't necessarily know where your next paycheck is coming from. You don't know if maybe you can cover the rent or what the next month looks like,
yeah.
You're very much just investing in yourself, hoping that it'll continue to come and grow, almost like a snowball getting bigger and bigger and bigger. But nobody necessarily talks about that aspect of entrepreneurship or owning a small business or working for yourself. They think it's glamorous. Oh, I don't have a boss. I could just hang out all day or take time off when I want. But you're literally working 24/7.
Yeah.
You don't have days off. You can't turn off. If you turn off, that's opportunities then you're losing to do something, to put yourself out there, to make more income, to build your brand. And so we were investing in ourselves, doing this full time, just going, 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 going. And then March 13th, 2020 hit.
Yeah.
And COVID. That was, everything got canceled.
Just stopped.
So
what did you do then?
So that, we didn't know what was going to happen. No one did.
Yeah.
We were mid-trip. We were looking, we were actually scouting a space where I was going to consult for a project in Kentucky.
Okay.
So I was in Kentucky as the world started closing.
Yeah.
And we were like, we got to get out of here. Like, this seems really serious.
Yeah.
Cut our trip early, went to the airport. Luckily, at the time, it was the only time I think I've seen airlines be accommodating.
Yeah.
They were like, oh, yeah, you got to get home. No change fees, airfare differences. Get on the next plane, go home.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, well, this must be.
Must be for real.
For real. because no one is like nickel and dime you for changing your flight or getting on an extra seat. And so we got back to LA, things locked up, shut down. As we all know, the world came almost to like a halt. And we weren't sure necessarily what to do other than cook. And so I just kept cooking. And I would just cook food that made me happy, that brought us both comfort. Yeah. I was making comfort food at home and documenting it on my phone and posting it on Instagram. And I think that was another one of those then turning points. I was already on Instagram. It wasn't like I picked my phone for the first time. And I would like post on Instagram our travels and journeys, but I wasn't like people following me necessarily for that or recreating anything I made. Yeah. They were just, I had a small following of people wanting to see what I was doing. And mostly were friends and colleagues and people like that. But then through that first month, I would post, you know, chicken noodle soup and ribs and cornbread or just random things I was making at home, tacos and tortillas, things I wanted to eat, posting about them. And it was blowing up. People were dumping on the bandwagon. I think everybody was looking for comfort. They were looking for familiarity. They were looking for almost like an escape of the constant information of like, no one knows what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Different stories from the media. Like, is this serious? Is this not serious? Can you go outside? You're not, you know, everything. And so people kind of latched on to the fact that I was cooking. My account grew significantly.
Yeah.
Within that first month. And I was like, okay, this is great. Like, let's just keep cooking.
Yeah.
And then slowly, like, brand offers started coming in. Like, hey, can you make a recipe for us? Hey, can you post about this? And at the same time, Chef's Feed, which is like a chef media company sort of thing, they reached out and they were like, well, we normally have a ticketing platform to host pop-ups. Obviously, you're not doing pop-ups and no one's doing pop-ups, but we still want to use this new platform we just built for selling tickets. Have you ever thought about doing virtual cooking classes? People are really into cooking right now. And I was like, I've actually never thought about doing that virtually. What would that look like? How does that work? I never used YouTube. Like, and I had to like, it was a very quick learning curve on how to do everything and set up and do all this electronic kind of tech stuff. And I wasn't like new to tech necessarily. Like I grew up around computers and tech. So I was like, it wasn't, oh my gosh, what is this? Cord. And so I did a cooking class and it just blew up. And then I did another one and another one and realized like people were really into it. People wanted to hear what I had to teach. And I was really good at teaching. I was really good at engaging people. I was really good at talking about it. And I realized it was like, you know, someone took the time to explain all these things to me or I thought I wouldn't have been where I'm at. So now I feel fortunate and grateful enough to be in a position where I get to spend my time teaching someone else all those things. And even if it's not a cook in the restaurant, it's someone at home, still a cook. Someone that loves food and wants to cook. And so it just kind of like grew and grew and grew. That turned into then us really being like, okay, this is a shift. We're not going anywhere anytime soon. Let's really invest in ourselves, kind of the brand, the business, working for ourselves. And, you know, we got a camera, we got some lights, we got a microphone, kind of the things to then upgrade from the regular iPhone.
Yeah.
Recording yourself. And then like editing software and really just kind of like one step at a time, learning, teaching myself along the way. And then with Ella being kind of like the creative inspiration and mind behind everything.
Yeah.
And then me just executing, we became a really good team at that and very good at doing everything digitally. So now we have this brand that creates content, that does recipe development, that works with brands. We have a lot of things behind the scenes people don't see that we work on in addition to what people see on Instagram. And we're just like so grateful and thankful for that opportunity where at the same time, we're seeing so many of our friends and colleagues the entire year closing their restaurants, losing jobs, having to lay people off. And it's just heartbreaking. So like at the same time, we're like, okay, now we have this platform. How can we help others? How can we do things? So, you know, some classes we started doing for charity, started trying to raise money for Northern California wildfires, raising charity for the NAACP, kind of if you have a platform, like, why would you not want to use it? Okay. Otherwise, what's the point if you're not going to then, like, try to help other people that don't?
You got to give back.
You got to give back. Otherwise, like, you're just, you're selfish or.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's like, you know, if you're worried about people leaving you because you say something or you stand up for something you believe in, then either one, you don't believe in it. Then that could be a problem in itself.
Yeah.
Or two, you don't need those people anyway.
Exactly.
Like, why would you want people, surround yourself with people who don't share the same beliefs as you?
Very true.
That's, you know, that's fake. I don't know.
Yeah.
I agree. Lack of a better word. So, you know, it became a really big, great thing. And now we're continuing to capitalize
on it. Kind of grow it. Yeah.
Grow it.
Do you see yourself going back to a restaurant?
You know, it's interesting you say that. I thought a lot about that. Not just recently, but over the past year.
Yeah.
And the goal had always been to go back to a restaurant. I wanted to open my own brick and mortar. That's kind of what we were building up to before COVID happened. Open a brick and mortar. We have a handful of concepts in mind. And now after doing this for the past year, yes, it's a grind, but it's a grind I enjoy. It's a different grind. We're working almost 30 days a month. We maybe take one day off for ourselves. And even that day is not really a day off. Maybe we're running errands. Mm-hmm. So it's not like, you know, we're just chilling, living off of a social media life, which a lot of people may take the wrong way when they see what people do on social media. There's a lot that goes on behind all
that. Oh, yeah, for sure.
And so I really enjoy it. I'm in no rush to go back to the 13 days a week, 16 hours a day life of running a restaurant.
Yeah.
I would still love to have a restaurant. And recently, I've been playing around with the idea in my head. I don't know how it would work, but like a chef doesn't need a restaurant to be a chef with a restaurant.
Mm-hmm.
So like breaking that down, you think about it, a chef doesn't need a restaurant to be a chef with a restaurant. So I could have a restaurant that maybe it's a ghost pop-up, something that moves or isn't constant in one location. And I'm able to cook for people and I'm able to be creative and I'm able to feed people and take care of people and create those memories. And that's kind of what started this whole journey was that hospitality and cooking for people.
Mm-hmm.
But figuring out a way to do that to maybe I'm not locked down and tied and anchored to something that is so much work, just as much work as I'm already doing, but with less return.
Yeah, for sure.
Because people don't realize, like, people like jump on chefs for thinking they're like millionaires or making tons of money off their restaurants or, like they're capitalizing on X, Y, and Z. When really, you know, like their margins are so small.
Yeah, it's not that much money.
Like, chefs
it's
are
impressive
not,
that chefs make as much money as they make.
Yeah, there's like, no, it is not a, the industry or the business to go into if you want to make money.
Yeah, no, this is.
There are better ways to make money. There are better ways and better investments to do than a restaurant. You know, I was talking to someone last night. They're like, if you took that same money you used to raise a restaurant, just put it into Bitcoin and wait a year, you'd have more money than you ever would putting it into a restaurant.
Yeah.
And it's like, it's funny, but true. Like, so yes, maybe Bitcoin's not the best example because it's completely unstable, but I think this last year showed us just how unstable restaurants are.
Oh, for sure. For sure.
And there's no guarantee on that either.
I think what we're realizing too is in our world is that success is no longer dictated by money.
That's true.
You know, you can be happy doing this. And as long as you have the things that you need and your loved ones next to you, then
that's it. Your that's success. It. Success is like one of those things that you have to put on and almost affirm yourself.
Yeah, exactly.
No one's going to tell you you're successful.
Yeah.
And even if they do, that's not going to make you feel successful.
No,
you need
not
to
at all.
Feel successful yourself. You need to tell yourself you're successful. You need to wake up every day and affirm it. You have to say it out loud. You have to put it out into the universe and believe it. If you don't do that, you could have millions of dollars and still never feel successful.
Exactly.
If you don't think you're successful.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that's a great example of the restaurant industry, of chefs in general, is that money doesn't define success.
Mm-hmm.
Being happy and believing in yourself and believing that you're successful does.
And helping people. And fucking, that's all that matters, to be honest. That's what I realized over this COVID shit, man. It's like, you don't, no one needs to follow that path that everyone thinks.
No, there's a lot of those paths out there that people do, I think, because they think that's the next thing to do in life.
Exactly.
And I think people are slowly learning and getting away from that. Mm-hmm. I don't know, it's something maybe from the 1950s, that like that whole American dream, buy a house, get married, yeah, have a kid. Like all these stages of life that you need to do to be successful. Or people are slowly realizing that's not the case.
Yeah. And, you know, people are out there every day changing the game and becoming successful in their own right, like yourself, you know. And I hope that it inspires the future generations to break the mold on what success is. And hopefully, you know, in 50 years, we can see a different future.
I think we are. We're on our way there. I mean, you see, I've read articles now recently where it's like kids in high school that are like figuring out ways to make passive income on their phones.
Yeah. That's badass.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Like things we've never thought were possible.
Yeah. It's only, I mean, I can't wait for this next generation. You uh-huh. know, they're going to be way better than we are. And there is sometimes when I catch myself like, God damn kids. But you know what? At the end of the day, like they're going to be awesome.
Yeah.
So I can't wait to see what happens to them. Chef, thank you very much for doing the show.
Thank you, Chef. Yeah, that was sure. That was a good conversation.
Hell yeah.
I do a lot of these podcasts and I haven't dove into that in as much detail.
Yeah.
With someone that understands it.
Yeah.
Like you, because you spend the same time in fine dining, those intense kitchens, mm-hmm. doing that same sort of grind.
Yeah.
And it's always good to kind of relive those memories and those defining moments.
Exactly.
And it makes you grateful for what you have and where you are, knowing you've accomplished all of that.
Yeah. I mean, I'm grateful that I can get people's story out there. And I'm grateful that I have that experience that makes you be able to be honest with what goes on in the kitchen and have somebody actually understand rather than, you know. And I was talking to a buddy of mine the other day, and he's like, you know, what business are we in? You know, and then ask yourself that again. What business are you in? And like slowly but surely, this is turning into sort of like a food journalism path for me. You know what I'm saying? And we'll see where it takes me. But it's obviously taking me to cool places as of now. So I can't wait to see where it goes in the future and where you go in the future. And that said, we'll have to do another show in the future.
Yeah, we will. Thank you. All right.
Fuck yeah. Sucio Talk signing off.